Good morning, Renegade Crafts Fair. This is Sarah Klein with Sarah Klein Santa Cruz. I am up early introducing myself as I am so honored to be a part of the fair this evening in their virtual shop. we didn't know about it until a little bit last minute, and I'm out of town, so I won't be able to be there this evening. But little quick hello, just to say thank you so much to all the people that follow me and support my art. It's kind of a surreal experience. You just kind of put yourself out there, and whatever feedback comes your way, it's quite rewarding and just humbling and so appreciative. Just all the people that give support and just say how much they appreciate and love my style and my perspective on art. So thank you. Little background. I think I just come from a really different background. I come from lots of artistic influence with family members and just experiences. Not entirely professionally trained, but I have had my fair share of art school and art classes. I think when I go into looking into a project, or if I find something, there's kind of two different aspects that I do. One, I definitely, you know, someone says, oh, can you paint me a watercolor? And you have to really almost interview and give that person, you know, try to understand what they're kind of looking for. But then also be able to have your style, because they want your style with their idea. Secondly, there's just like, I just get inspired by the little things in life, mostly nature, but also a lot of like graphic art. I think I really just love pop art. It's really fun. And pop culture is really fun, and color. I mean, color just sort of blows me away. It can just change the day and the mood since a heartbeat. So if there's something that just goes, ah, paint me. And then I think the final thing is it just brings up great sense of accomplishment. You know, you're kind of running around in the rat race of life and all the things that we do. And definitely having a creative outlet is such a like special talent, I suppose, it's just an outlet of being able to sort of put whatever you're feeling on paper. So, one more thing. I think I would like to say, you know, I love the things that I've created. I love the designs that we have. I really look forward to the future, and just with all the support that people have put towards me, it really gives me the ability to go, okay, like I can really push myself and like go and make better and more creative designs as we go forward. So anyway, you guys enjoy and take a look at everything. Some things I think might be new, some things are old, but please enjoy yourselves. Thank you for coming out and in supporting all the artists with Renegade Craft Fair. This COVID-19 has been really hard, so you know, it's put the pressure on everybody to like find a creative way to go forward and survive. So anyway, have a lovely evening, and I'm going to turn the video over to my co-founder and my my rock and my cousin, my sister. She's huge support of everything, and her vision definitely helps in so many ways. So Jill Grant is going to take it from here. So enjoy, guys. Have a great night. Bye.
Happy Friday, everyone. We're so glad you're here at the Renegade Art Craft Fair. I know it's a virtual pop-up and we wish we could all be in person, but hopefully this time next year we'll all be able to do that. But we're just really excited to be able to have this opportunity at Sarah Klein Santa Cruz. My name is Jill Grant. I'm the co-founder of Sarah Klein with my cousin Sarah. And we grew up together in California and just have always done business together and always, you know, just always been in each other's lives. And about a year and a half ago, Sarah has always done artwork, and she had this idea to put it on some organic pea gauze. It's a cotton, like a muslin, and she got sick of the kids dragging their wet beach towels through the house, and she lives right on the shore in Santa Cruz. And so she put on this pea gauze that, you know, dries quickly, it doesn't track sand, and so it made things a lot easier. It was sort of a mom convenience. And people started to see the wraps, and then we made these big beach sheets, like a picnic blanket, and started asking, you know, where do we buy these? And I live in Charlottesville, Virginia, and Sarah said, well, you've got the business background, can you figure out how we do production? And so I just fortunately stumbled upon a great group of interns from the University of Virginia, and we've taken it from there that, you know, we started with really beach wraps and towels and sheets, but now we're moving more into like home goods. We've got these pillows with some of our new designs. I think one of the things that makes our enterprise interesting that I didn't realize walking into this is just that we didn't have the capital to hold a lot of inventory. We work out of my house, and so we've been able to work with companies like Printful, where we get our pillows and do drop shipments. So we sign off on a demo, and then when a customer makes an order, they just ship it directly to the customer, which has been great. And we're just excited to be part of this arts and crafts community. We've had so many people behind us that have been not just supportive, but really giving us great constructive feedback, showing us how business works. And we're proud to be part of tonight that's supporting the Black Arts Futures Fund. And we just look to this community as, you know, a good group that's collaborative and supportive of each other. Apparently my dog thinks that it's time to take a nap, but while he's taking a nap, I'm gonna show you guys a quick video of some of our products from last winter, and then we're gonna go make a margarita. So come join me. Thank you. The little video that we showed you of our products. It was just from a pop-up we did last year. And we have a group of our interns that are here. Sarah and I could not get through the day without our interns from the University of Virginia. They're gonna talk a little bit about our products and what they do.
Hi, I'm Zoe.
And I'm Hannah.
And today we are wearing the new Sarah Klein Santa Cruz Captains. I'm wearing the Iris.
And I'm wearing the Blue Leaf.
And so these are so cool because they're made out of the same material as our wraps and our tea towels, which is the 100% organic pea gauze cotton. And it's super soft and super absorbent, which is why we love it. And we ended up turning it into these captains. So they're super new. We're just now adding them into the website. We're really excited about that. And then here we also have our tumblers. And these actually were my idea. So I'm super excited about them. And you can see the other ones in the back. And we've been using them for our cocktail hours, actually our virtual cocktail hours. And they've been a great addition, and they include all of Sarah's designs. So this one is actually our Longhorn design, which has become one of our best sellers and is absolutely amazing. And throughout the year, we also do a ton of pop-ups, which Hannah can talk about.
We'll have all of these products and more at all our pop-ups. We do a lot across Virginia, our last one in Highland, I think it was. and come see us.
Yes, definitely. And back to Jill for some cocktails and some beeswax paper.
Thank you, guys. Okay, so as Zoe mentioned, we are big fans of this organic pea gauze. It was something that Sarah found, when, like I said earlier, when she got started, she found this pea gauze on Spoonflower and she was using it as beach towels and beach wraps, and then we figured why not try it as a tea towel because it's so absorbent, and a lot of the dishcloths I get, they don't absorb a lot of water, and so we just added some of our designs to that, and it's nice because we can repurpose our pea gauze into the wraps, the caftans, the tea towels. So we're gonna make a little cocktail really quickly. This is our pink grapefruit margarita, which only have one. I'm just gonna tell you that right now. Just drink one. They're a little strong, but 2 cups of pink grapefruit juice, 1 cup of white tequila. I just love Casamigos, but that's just my preference. And then 1 cup of Cointreau, and these are really strong. So as you can tell, but they're just a nice summer drink to nurse along. And then we just always love to just pour them into our tumblers. And serve them with some of our favorite guacamole, which is super easy. I'm just the queen of convenient cooking because I'm always on the go. So we do a guacamole with holy guacamole, and then I just add equal parts of tomato, cilantro, and red onion, and cocktail hour is ready. And as you saw, we used our beeswax paper to wrap up our guacamole, and Grace will talk a little bit about that because it's important to us that we use our scrap material and be a sustainable company and have another way of using our scraps.
Yeah, so I'm gonna talk a little bit about how we turn our scrap material into beeswax paper. So I take the beeswax, melt it down in the pot, and then once the beeswax is liquid, I just swipe it on to the pieces of scrap paper that we have, trying to do it as evenly as possible. Meanwhile, preheat the oven to 200 degrees, try to get it even, cover all the edges, and then as soon as they're done, you put it in the oven and the beeswax will soak through, and you can just use these little papers to cover up your food, like something that you would put in plastic wrap, so you don't have to waste stuff in your kitchen, and we can also be more sustainable in how we use our paper.
So yeah, and I think Grace made a great find. A lot of times when you read the directions to make beeswax paper, they say wax on both sides, like put it in the oven for a few minutes at 200 degrees, pull it out, and then turn it over and add beeswax to the other side. And we just found that it was getting too thick.
So it was getting too thick.
Yeah, so we just are doing it one side. And I think with the cotton that we're using, it's the same cotton we're using for our face mask. It just sort of penetrates and just, yeah, it goes right through.
It just soaks through, and then it has an even coating on both sides.
Yeah, so. Awesome. So we're going to take you now, as you can tell, we work out of my house, and I think that we are probably like most small businesses that are just getting started. So we're gonna take you into what was my dining room and is now one of our work rooms, where we got some of our new table linens set up, and then Amanda Geyer, another UVA intern, is going to show how she's taken some of our other scrap material and turned it into scrunchies that we've just been giving away with orders, because it's just sort of nice to put a little something in with each order that we get. And so come with me. All right, come follow me. We're gonna go look at some of our new table linens and learn how to make a scrunchie with our intern, Amanda. So we have been really lucky that we have a Spoonflower who has a company called Roostery that we can mock up any sort of table designs. Like we've got table placemats, table runners, napkins, and we don't have to order inventory. We're able to mock it up, take samples to pop-ups with us, or have it on our website, and then when people order it, we just ship it directly to them. It's been wonderful, but also it just saves us a lot of money. I mean, we're a new company and we have to, you know, watch every penny, and so to be able to have a company like Spoonflower and Roostery where we can mock things up, try things out. You know, for instance, we've tried the placemats in a couple of different types of material. This is the material, a more rough cotton that we like, just because most people are gonna use it for outdoor use. But we're gonna start bringing these to pop-ups and have them on our website in the next few weeks.
And Amanda Geyer, who's a fourth year at UVA, is going to show you guys how to make a scrunchie. So again, because of the sustainability piece, we think it's really important to not waste any materials. So we've taken old pea gauze from wraps that we cut and we've turned them into scrunchies. And Amanda's gonna show you guys how to do it because it's super easy.
Hi guys. So first thing you wanna do when you're gonna make a scrunchie is you wanna cut your fabric. And this piece of fabric is 3.5 inches wide by 22 inches long. But if you wanted to have a thicker, fluffier scrunchie, you can adjust that to 4.5 inches wide by 20 inches long. And the first step is to fold your fabric lengthwise with the print on the inside. So it's gonna be inside out. And then you're gonna sew a seam right on the edge here. So now it's time to put the elastic inside. So for a scrunchie this size, we're gonna use a 9-inch piece of elastic. But like I said before, if you wanted one that's thicker, you could trim that down to 6 inches. And this part's a little bit tricky, so it helps if you pin the elastic to one end of the fabric. And then you just gotta kind of reach through and pull your elastic. And it takes a minute.
Improvising, but the scrunchies are, that's gonna be the biggest piece with the scrunchies, is just the elastic piece. So, but once you get it through, which I think it looks like you've got.
Yeah, so once you've got it pulled through, it starts to take the shape of an actual scrunchie, and you can pull your pin out and grab your other end, and then you just wanna tie it in a simple knot. Like this. And then you just kind of position the ends so that they overlap. And then the last step is just to sew one more seam right here to connect it all. And then you just trim your thread. Be a little tricky with some sewing machines because it likes to grab the fabric. I can't get it out. So it'll end up looking something like this. That's your finished product.
Awesome, Amanda. Thank you. Amanda's been a superstar. This is what she's been focusing on the last few weeks. Okay, so next up is Hildy. She's gonna just graduate from UVA. She is going to take you into our workroom and show you a little bit about our scarves and wraps and whatnot. So let's go.
So this is our workshop. It's the back room of Jill's house, and as you can see, we've had to kind of make the most of the little space that we have here, like any small business that runs out of the home. So one of the things that I know Jill has talked about a lot and is really important to our company is the fact that we use the same material for a lot of our different products, and we try to innovate and create new stuff with that. So, for example, we have our beach sheet, which is made out of the same organic 100% cotton material that the caftans and the tea towels are all made out of. So this is our orange starfish pattern in the beach sheet. And that can be used as like a picnic blanket, a beach blanket, towel, really anything. It's a great, just big material thing for you to use. And then the second other popular product that we use is our beach wrap, and this is our pineapple print. And the beach wraps are great because you can use them as a sarong. I can show you, you can tie them sort of like this. And you get a little cute little skirt going on there. Or you can use them as more of like a wrap shawl-esque kind of thing when you're out of the water, kind of dry off. These are really, really absorbent. So they're great to use at the pool, at the beach, really anything, or just for a fashion statement if you wanted to do that too. And then also in here we have our scarves that are made out of a chiffon material, and they're super lightweight, really kind of almost transparent, but not really. And they come in a bunch of different patterns. They go with all kinds of stuff, like a white t-shirt and jeans would be a great look for our scarves. And then we also have all of our note cards that are made out of some pretty heavy duty cardstock. So they don't bend, they hold up really well in the mail. We've got all of our different animal patterns and prints that you can send for thank you notes, all that kind of stuff. So yeah, this is where the magic happens.
And now we're gonna show you how to make one of these beautiful wraps.
So I hope you guys enjoyed learning how to make a wrap. This was all new to me. A year and a half ago, I had never even touched a sewing machine. I didn't know what a serger was. And I was really lucky that there's an awesome yarn store and sewing store in Charlottesville, U-Fibers, that literally has shown me how to do everything from serging to sewing to making dresses. So you're never too old to take on a new hobby or learn a new skill set I've learned. But probably the thing that I'm most excited about as we're getting to the holiday season, and I know it seems it's a far away, far, far away, but when I used to consult with QVC, they started their Christmas selling at the end of July. So I'm gonna just follow their lead since they seem to know what they're doing. But this is our new Minky throw blanket, which I don't know about you guys, but when I love the winter time, I like hole up, I'm always reading books on my couch. And I just love something comfy and cozy. This is also something that you can just put at the end of your bed during the summertime. This is our banana leaf print, which is new. And Taylor, our intern, is waving her favorite Minky blanket, her Dia de Muertos. Taylor.
It's just really nice and lightweight. It's a fun pattern. And like Jill said, I also love being super cozy. Who doesn't? And it's a fun thing to just throw around you when you're going around the house or kind of chilling on the couch. Add a little pop of color, make something fun and different. And what's super cool about the Minky material is it's nice and warm, but not too heavy, so you're not feeling overwhelmed by this big blanket on maybe a cooler summer afternoon or evening.
No, and I think you're right that's what I was learning, because like I hate having in the summer like the duvet cover.
Yeah, exactly.
It's too much, but this is like a perfect weight for like a light blanket. And this also is just sort of giving us some inspiration for bedding, which we're looking at right now. We have this awesome company in Portugal that we're hoping to work with. And we're hoping by the holidays to have some bedding out. So if you have thoughts of patterns you'd like to see, we're thinking mussels, banana leaves, what else?
Feathers, I believe.
The feathers as well. And the blue leaves, the caftan, that same pattern that Hannah was wearing. So anyways, thank you guys for tuning in and just getting to learn a little about our business. We are so grateful for the support we've had, and this truly was an organic endeavor. It was, as I said earlier, Sarah had some artwork and she put it on this pea gauze, and I have a business background. And you know, we've been so blessed with the community of artists and craftsmen that have taken us under their wing and shown us how to do business and how to make things work. And we hope that as we evolve, we can support the artists that are emerging. And just that, you know, this is a good community and there's room for all of us, and just let's all be collaborative. And we're just glad to have this evening tonight. So thank you. I'm back. Okay, so we've had a bunch of questions come in about some of our products and dimensions and just a little more information. People were wondering about the fabric, so come back in the workroom and let's chat.
Okay, so our beach sheets are really what I would always tell people are like the size of a picnic blanket. So they are 72 by 52 and they're just a good, you know, like I said, a picnic blanket you can take to the beach. And also, you know, some people just like to wrap themselves all the way up in it. It's like a nice little blanket that some people have been throwing them on top of their beds just to wear it, have a little throw. Our wraps are 36 by 52. And again, we trim everything, we serge it and trim everything. So it just has our label on it, looks good to go. And then I always get asked this, what's my favorite product? And my favorite product is the tea towel. These towels are about 32 by 18 and they are the most useful thing I've ever had. I find like a lot of dish towels don't do well actually absorbing water, but these do. And they're also great because you can use them as a dishcloth. You can, some people have put them in their bathrooms as hand towels. We have a customer who uses our whale sharks for her son in his bathroom. And the other thing I love about the tea towel and just this material in general is that the more you wash it, the softer it gets. This is like a baby swaddle and it really does stand up the test of time. This has probably been washed every week for the last 6 months. And so we have stuff that we're still using from a year ago. So I am really impressed with the quality of the material. And then also just our scarves. That question came up about the dimensions. And they are 25 by 72. And they're just a nice little wrap you can wear in the summer or a scarf you can wear, you know, in the fall and winter. A lot of our UVA interns love that this is their favorite scarf. But the other question that came up was just, we've been making masks, which I failed to mention earlier in this live stream. And so we're gonna show you guys how to make a mask. So come with me back into the dining room and our other little workspace. Okay, so making a mask, we have been making a lot of these lately, just obviously because of the circumstances with COVID-19. We found a material similar to like a duvet cover or a pillowcase through Spoonflower, and we found that people really wanted small masks, and you know, some people are just a little bit smaller, and then also kid masks that we've cut in a 6x14 pattern. This is one of our butterfly patterns that Sarah painted. And then we've also got the feathers that we've done in our adult sizes are 8x16. And so we double it up and the material really does hold well. It's, you know, 2-ply, it's 100% cotton, so it breathes well, especially in the summer heat. But the big trick to making masks, in my opinion, is use your iron. We have found that the iron is a critical piece to this. So let me just sort of show you what we do. I fold it inside out in half and I add a 1-inch seam to each side. Of the mask, and then that way what it does is you have a place to put your filter. Almost backstitched you. One thing I've learned in my year and a half of sewing. Anyways, so I've got a demo ready. So this has been ironed and we ironed it, we've flipped it over and then ironed it flat like this, so that you've got your filter in the back, and then that way it's not, some people have been putting on the top or bottom, but we found just in the back was easier. And then also by ironing it, it gives you your four corners, which makes it a lot easier to add your ribbon and seam it. So this is one that we've already started and we've just been using a fun ribbon that we found the grosgrain ribbon worked a little bit better. It's easier to tie. You know, a lot of people that are using masks are of age, and so we wanted something that they could use a plastic zip cord with and tie their masks easily, but also they stay tied really well. But we just feed the ribbon in through the filter and then pin it to a corner.
and pinning's also important. But then just go ahead and seam it. I leave a little bit of a seam allowance, and again, backstitch. And do the other side. Some people, I think everyone has a different preference for how tight their seams are. I leave mine at 2.2, that's just a personal preference. And then just pull it out. I always trim the corners. I think when you go to turn it inside out and fold it, it just makes it a little bit of an easier crease. Take the pins out. I've made the mistake of forgetting to take the pins out. And then what was probably the most complicated thing for me to learn about with the mask, you turn it inside out, I just pull one of the ribbons through and it turns itself in. And you can see that this is one of our Longhorn designs. You can see you've got the filter pocket in the back, and it's just a nice, it's nicely seamed. For me, the pleating was the hardest thing to learn. It really was sort of like an exercise in dexterity. I know that some directions say do three pleats. I only did two. I thought that when we were test driving the mask, they were a little bit more comfortable and had a little bit more give with just the two pleats. But again, it's just a personal preference. But we do about 1-inch pleats and just, you know, like so. And this is again where your iron comes in very handy. Definitely, I always just iron the back of the mask, flatten it down. It makes it easier to seam. And then this is an example. This is one that I already went ahead and pinned and ironed. And you can just see it's just going to make it a little bit more easier to do a final stitch on. The other thing that just, you know, personal preference, but I have found that it's a little bit easier on the sewing machine if you use a 90 size needle. It's long enough that it can get through the thick material. I made the mistake of trying a smaller needle at one point, and I think my machine made a noise like it wanted to just explode. Sort of like that. But there you go. And then these are washable. We do suggest to people, just because we want them to last as long as possible, wash them in a garment bag. The ties don't get tied up. We've been asked a lot why we haven't used elastic. And again, we've just found when we test drove the elastic, it fell apart even in the garment bag. And so we want, again, we're all gonna be wearing these masks for a while, so we want something that's gonna last you guys. There's a lot of different ways you can tie these. You can tie them in the back of your head. You can do a slip knot so they're easy to get on and off. Like I said, we also have been giving people zip cords, those zip ties, so you can just, you know, on and off each time, you don't have to worry about it. I just wear mine around my ears because I'm putting it on and off so many times. Just do a cute bow and around my ears. Pleats, oops, hold on, wait a minute. There we go, pleats down, and you can just extend it to how big you want it to be. But the bow is just, it's just easy to put on and off. So that's just one of the ways we've been doing them.
Hope that helps. If you have more questions or thoughts, just email us at info@sarahkleincreative. We're always happy to hear your feedback. Thanks so much.
This is Sarah Klein with Sarah Klein Santa Cruz. I am up early introducing myself as I am so honored to be a part of the fair this evening in their virtual shop. We didn't know about it until a little bit last minute, and I'm out of town, so I won't be able to be there this evening. But little quick hello, just to say thank you so much to all the people that follow me and support my art. It's kind of a surreal experience. You just kind of put yourself out there, and whatever feedback comes your way, it's quite rewarding and just humbling and so appreciative. Just all the people that give support and just say how much they appreciate and love my style and my perspective on art. So thank you. Little background. I think I just come from a really different background. I come from lots of artistic influence with family members and just experiences. Not entirely professionally trained, but I have had my fair share of art school and art classes. I think when I go into looking into a project, or if I find something, there's kind of two different aspects that I do. One, I definitely, you know, someone says, oh, can you paint me a watercolor? And you have to really almost interview and give that person, you know, try to understand what they're kind of looking for, but then also be able to have your style, because they want your style with their idea. Secondly, there's just like, I just get inspired by the little things in life, mostly nature, but also a lot of like graphic art. I think I really just love pop art. It's really fun. And pop culture is really fun, and color. I mean, color just sort of blows me away. It can just change the day and the mood since a heartbeat. So if there's something that just goes, ah, paint me. And then I think the final thing is it just brings up great sense of accomplishment. You know, you're kind of running around the rat race of life and all the things that we do. And definitely having a creative outlet is such a like special talent, I suppose, it's just an outlet of being able to sort of put whatever you're feeling on paper. So, one more thing. I think I would like to say, you know, I love the things that I've created. I love the designs that we have. I really look forward to the future, and just with all the support that people have put towards me, it really gives me the ability to go, okay, like I can really push myself and like go and make better and more creative designs as we go forward. So anyway, you guys enjoy and take a look at everything. Some things I think might be new, some things are old, but please enjoy yourselves. Thank you for coming out and in supporting all the artists with Renegade Craft Fair. This COVID-19 has been really hard, so you know, it's put the pressure on everybody to like find a creative way to go forward and survive. So anyway, have a lovely evening, and I'm going to turn the video over to my co-founder and my my rock and my cousin, my sister. She's huge support of everything, and her vision definitely helps in so many ways. So Jill Grant is going to take it from here. So enjoy, guys. Have a great night. Bye.
Happy Friday, everyone. We're so glad you're here at the Renegade Art Craft Fair. I know it's a virtual pop-up, and we wish we could all be in person, but hopefully this time next year we'll all be able to do that. But we're just really excited to be able to have this opportunity at Sarah Klein Santa Cruz. My name is Jill Grant. I'm the co-founder of Sarah Klein with my cousin Sarah. And we grew up together in California and just have always done business together and always, you know, just always been in each other's lives. And about a year and a half ago, Sarah has always done artwork and she had this idea to put it on some organic pea gauze. It's a cotton, like a muslin. And she got sick of the kids dragging their wet beach towels through the house, and she lives right on the shore in Santa Cruz. And so she put on this pea gauze that, you know, dries quickly, it doesn't track sand, and so it made things a lot easier. It was sort of a mom convenience. And people started to see the wraps, and then we made these big beach sheets, like a picnic blanket, and started asking, you know, where do we buy these? And I live in Charlottesville, Virginia, and Sarah said, well, you've got the business background, can you figure out how we do production? And so I've just fortunately stumbled upon a great group of interns from the University of Virginia, and we've taken it from there that, you know, we started with really beach wraps and towels and sheets, but now we're moving more into like home goods. We've got these pillows with some of our new designs. I think one of the things that makes our enterprise interesting that I didn't realize walking into this is just that we didn't have the capital to hold a lot of inventory. We work out of my house, and so we've been able to work with companies like Printful, where we get our pillows and do drop shipments. So we sign off on a demo, and then when a customer makes an order, they just ship it directly to the customer, which has been great. And we're just excited to be part of this arts and crafts community. We've had so many people behind us that have been not just supportive, but really giving us great constructive feedback, showing us how business works. And we're proud to be part of tonight that's supporting the Black Arts Futures Fund. And we just look to this community as, you know, a good group that's collaborative and supportive of each other. Apparently my dog thinks that it's time to take a nap, but while he's taking a nap, I'm gonna show you guys a quick video of some of our products from last winter, and then we're gonna go make a margarita. So come join me. Thank you. The little video that we showed you of our products. It was just from a pop-up we did last year. And we have a group of our interns that are here. Sarah and I could not get through the day without our interns from the University of Virginia. They're gonna talk a little bit about our products and what they do.
Hi, I'm Zoe.
And I'm Hannah.
And today we are wearing the new Sarah Klein Santa Cruz Captains. I'm wearing the Iris.
And I'm wearing the Blue Leaf.
And so these are so cool because they're made out of the same material as our wraps and our tea towels, which is the 100% organic pea gauze cotton. And it's super soft and super absorbent, which is why we love it. And we ended up turning it into these captains. So they're super new. We're just now adding them into the website. We're really excited about that. And then here we also have our tumblers. And these actually were my idea. So I'm super excited about them. You can see the other ones in the back. and we've been using them for our cocktail hours, actually our virtual cocktail hours, and they've been a great addition, and they include all of Sarah's designs. So this one is actually our Longhorn design, which has become one of our best sellers and is absolutely amazing. And throughout the year, we also do a ton of pop-ups, which Hannah can talk about.
We'll have all of these products and more at all our pop-ups. We do a lot across Virginia, our last one in Highland, I think it was. And come see us.
Yes, definitely. And back to Jill for some cocktails and some beeswax paper.
Thank you guys. Okay, so as Zoe mentioned, we are big fans of this organic pea gauze. It was something that Sarah found, when, like I said earlier, when she got started, she found this pea gauze on Spoonflower and she was using it as beach towels and beach wraps, and then we figured why not try it as a tea towel because it's so absorbent, and a lot of the dishcloths I get, they don't absorb a lot of water, and so we just added some of our designs to that, and it's nice because we can repurpose our pea gauze into the wraps, the caftans, the tea towels. So we're gonna make a little cocktail really quickly. This is our pink grapefruit margarita, which only have one. I'm just gonna tell you that right now. Just drink one. They're a little strong, but 2 cups of pink grapefruit juice, 1 cup of white tequila. I just love Casamigos, but that's just my preference. And then 1 cup of Cointreau, and these are really strong. So as you can tell, but they're just a nice summer drink to nurse along. And then we just always love to just pour them into our tumblers and serve them with some of our favorite guacamole, which is super easy. I'm just the queen of convenient cooking because I'm always on the go. So we do a guacamole with holy guacamole, and then I just add equal parts of tomato, cilantro, and red onion, and cocktail hour is ready. And as you saw, we used our beeswax paper to wrap up our guacamole, and Grace will talk a little bit about that because it's important to us that we use our scrap material and be a sustainable company and have another way of using our scraps.
Yeah, so I'm gonna talk a little bit about how we turn our scrap material into beeswax paper. So I take the beeswax, melt it down in the pot, and then once the beeswax is liquid, I just swipe it on to the pieces of scrap paper that we have, trying to do it as evenly as possible. Meanwhile, preheat the oven to 200 degrees, try to get it even, cover all the edges, and then as soon as they're done, you put it in the oven and the beeswax will soak through, and you can just use these little papers to cover up your food, like something that you would put in plastic wrap, so you don't have to waste stuff in your kitchen, and we can also be more sustainable in how we use our paper.
Yeah, and I think Grace made a great find. A lot of times when you read the directions to make beeswax paper, they say wax on both sides, like put it in the oven for a few minutes at 200 degrees, pull it out, and then turn it over and add beeswax to the other side. And we just found that it was getting too thick. Yeah, so we just are doing it one side, and I think with the cotton that we're using, it's the same cotton we're using for our face mask. It just sort of penetrates and just, yeah, it goes right through.
It just soaks through, and then it has an even coating on both sides.
Yeah, so awesome. So we're going to take you now, as you can tell, we work out of my house, and I think that we are probably like most small businesses are just getting started. So we're gonna take you into what was my dining room and is now one of our work rooms where we've got some of our new table linens set up, and then Amanda Geyer, another UVA intern, is going to show how she's taken some of our other scrap material and turned it into scrunchies that we've just been giving away with orders because it's just sort of nice to put a little something in with each order that we get, and so come with me.
All right, come follow me. We're gonna go look at some of our new table linens and learn how to make a scrunchie with our intern, Amanda. So we have been really lucky that we have a Spoonflower who has a company called Roostery that we can mock up any sort of table designs. Like we've got table placemats, table runners, napkins, and we don't have to order inventory. We're able to
mock it up, take samples to pop-ups with us or have it on our website, and then when people order it, we just ship it directly to them. It's been wonderful, but also it just saves us a lot of money. I mean, we're a new company and we have to, you know, watch every penny, and so to be able to have a company like Spoonflower and Roostery where we can mock things up, try things out, you know, for instance, we've tried the placemats in a couple of different types of material. This is the material, a more rough cotton that we like, just because most people are gonna use it for outdoor use. But we're gonna start bringing these to pop-ups and have them on our website in the next few weeks. And Amanda Geyer, who's a fourth year at UVA, is going to show you guys how to make a scrunchie. So again, because of the sustainability piece, we think it's really important to not waste any material. So we've taken old pea gauze from wraps that we cut and we've turned them into scrunchies. And Amanda's gonna show you guys how to do it because it's super easy.
Hi guys. So first thing you wanna do when you're gonna make the scrunchie is you wanna cut your fabric. And this piece of fabric is 3.5 inches wide by 22 inches long. But if you wanted to have a thicker, fluffier scrunchie, you can adjust that to 4.5 inches wide by 20 inches long. And the first step is to fold your fabric lengthwise with the print on the inside. So it's gonna be inside out. Then you're gonna sew a seam right on the edge here. Elastic inside. So for a scrunchie this size, we're going to use a 9-inch piece of elastic, but like I said before, if you wanted one that's thicker, you could trim that down to 6 inches. And this part's a little bit tricky, so it helps if you pin the elastic to one end of the fabric, and then you just got to kind of reach through and pull your elastic, and it takes a minute.
It's good for people to see how this isn't always easy. We were always sort of like, you know, improvising. But the scrunchies are, that's going to be the biggest piece with the scrunchies. It's just the elastic piece. So, but once you get it through, which I think it looks like you've got.
Yeah, so once you've got it pulled through, it starts to take the shape of an actual scrunchie. And you can pull your pin out and grab your other end. And then you just want to tie it in a simple knot, like this. And then you just kind of position the ends so that they overlap. And then the last step is just to sew one more seam right here to connect it all. And you just trim your thread. It can be a little tricky with some sewing machines because it likes to grab the fabric. I can't get it out. So it'll end up looking something like this. That's your finished product.
Awesome, Amanda, thank you. Amanda's been a superstar. This is what she's been focusing on the last few weeks. Okay, so next up is Hildy. She's gonna just graduate from UVA. She's going to take you into our workroom and show you a little bit about our scarves and wraps and whatnot. So let's go.
So this is our workshop. It's the back room of Jill's house, and as you can see, we've had to kind of make the most of the little space that we have here, like any small business that runs out of the home. So one of the things that I know Jill has talked about a lot and is really important to our company is the fact that we use the same material for a lot of our different products, and we try to innovate and create new stuff with that. So For example, we have our beach sheet, which is made out of the same organic 100% cotton material that the caftans and the tea towels are all made out of. So this is our orange starfish pattern in the beach sheet. And that can be used as like a picnic blanket, a beach blanket, towel, really anything. It's a great, just big material thing for you to use. And then the second other popular product that we use is our beach wrap, and this is our pineapple print. And the beach wraps are great because you can use them as a sarong. I can show you, you can tie them sort of like this, and you get a little cute little skirt going on there. Or you can use them as more of like a wrap shawl-esque kind of thing when you're out of the water, kind of dry off. These are really, really absorbent. So they're great to use at the pool, at the beach, really anything, or just for a fashion statement, if you wanted to do that too. And then also in here we have our scarves that are made out of a chiffon material, and they're super lightweight, really kind of almost transparent, but not really. And they come in a bunch of different patterns. They go with all kinds of stuff, like a white t-shirt and jeans would be a great look for our scarves. And then we also have all of our note cards that are made out of some pretty heavy duty cardstock. So they don't bend, they hold up really well in the mail. We've got all of our different animal patterns and prints that you can send for thank you notes, all that kind of stuff. So yeah, this is where the magic happens. And now we're gonna show you how to make one of these beautiful wraps.
So I hope you guys enjoyed learning how to make a wrap. This was all new to me. A year and a half ago, I had never even touched a sewing machine. I didn't know what a serger was. And I was really lucky that there's an awesome yarn store and sewing store in Charlottesville, U-Fibers, that literally has shown me how to do everything from serging to sewing to making dresses. So you're never too old to take on a new hobby or learn a new skill set I've learned. But probably the thing that I'm most excited about as we're getting to the holiday season, and I know it seems it's a far away, far, far away, but when I used to consult with QVC, they started their Christmas selling at the end of July. So I'm gonna just follow their lead since they seem to know what they're doing. But this is our new Minky throw blanket, which I don't know about you guys, but when I love the wintertime, I like hole up, I'm always reading books on my couch. And I just love something comfy and cozy. This is also something that you can just put at the end of your bed during the summertime. This is our banana leaf print, which is new. And Taylor, our intern, is waving her favorite Minky blanket, her Dia de Muertos. Taylor.
It's just really nice and lightweight. It's a fun pattern. And like Jill said, I also love being super cozy. Who doesn't? And it's a fun thing to just throw around you when you're going around the house or kind of chilling on the couch. Add a little pop of color, make something fun and different. And what's super cool about the Minky material is it's nice and warm, but not too heavy, so you're not feeling overwhelmed by this big blanket on maybe a cooler summer afternoon or evening.
No, and I think you're right that's what I was learning. It's like, I hate having in the summer, like the duvet cover.
Yeah, exactly.
It's too much, but this is like a perfect weight for like a light blanket. And this also is just sort of giving us some inspiration for bedding, which we're looking at right now. We have this awesome company in Portugal that we're hoping to work with. And we're hoping by the holidays to have some bedding out. So if you have thoughts of patterns you'd like to see, we're thinking mussels, banana leaves, what else?
Feathers, I believe.
The feathers as well. And the blue leaves, the caftan, that same pattern that Hannah was wearing.
So anyways, thank you guys for tuning in and just getting to learn a little about our business. We are so grateful for the support we've had, and this truly was an organic endeavor. It was, as I said earlier, Sarah had some artwork and she put it on this pea gauze, and I have a business background. And you know, we've been so blessed with the community of artists and craftsmen that have taken us under their wing and shown us how to do business and how to make things work. And we hope that as we evolve, we can support the artists that are emerging. And just that, you know, this is a good community and there's room for all of us, and just let's all be collaborative. And we're just glad to have this evening tonight. So thank you. I'm back. Okay, so we've had a bunch of questions come in about some of our products and dimensions, and just a little more information. People were wondering about the fabric. So come back in the workroom and let's chat. Okay, so our beach sheets are really what I would always tell people are like the size of a picnic blanket. So they are 72 by 52. And they're just a good, you know, like I said, a picnic blanket you can take to the beach. And also, you know, some people just like to wrap themselves all the way up in it. It's like a nice little blanket that some people have been throwing them on top of their beds just to wear it, have a little throw. Our wraps are 36 by 52. And again, we trim everything, we serge it and trim everything, so it just has our label on it, looks good to go. And then I always get asked this, what's my favorite product? And my favorite product is the tea towel. These towels are about 32 by 18 and they are the most useful thing I've ever had. I find like a lot of dish towels don't do well actually absorbing water, but these do. And they're also great because you can use them as a dishcloth. You can, some people have put them in their bathrooms as hand towels. We have a customer who uses our whale sharks for her son in his bathroom. And the other thing I love about the tea towel and just this material in general is that the more you wash it, the softer it gets. This is like a baby swaddle and it really does stand up the test of time. This has probably been washed every week for the last 6 months. And so we have stuff that we're still using from a year ago. So I am really impressed with the quality of the material. And then also just our scarves. That question came up about the dimensions. And they are 25 by 72. And they're just a nice little wrap you can wear in the summer, or a scarf you can wear, you know, in the fall and winter. A lot of our UVA interns love that this is their favorite scarf. But the other question that came up was just, we've been making masks, which I failed to mention earlier in this live stream. And so we're gonna show you guys how to make a mask. So come with me back into the dining room and our other little workspace. Okay, so making a mask, we have been making a lot of these lately, just obviously because of the circumstances with COVID-19. We found a material similar to like a duvet cover or a pillowcase through Spoonflower, and we found that people really wanted small masks, and you know, some people are just a little bit smaller, and then also kid masks that we've cut in a 6x14 pattern. This is one of our butterfly patterns that Sarah painted. And then we've also got the feathers that we've done in our adult sizes are 8x16. And so we double it up and the material really does hold well. It's, you know, 2-ply, it's 100% cotton, so it breathes well, especially in the summer heat. But the big trick to making masks, in my opinion, is use your iron. We have found that the iron is a critical piece to this. So let me just sort of show you what we do. I fold it inside out in half and I add a 1-inch seam to each side. Of the mask, and then that way what it does is you have a place to put your filter. Almost backstitched you. One thing I've learned in my year and a half of sewing. Anyways, so I've got a demo ready. So this has been ironed, and we ironed it, we've flipped it over, ironed it flat like this, so that you've got your
filter in the back. And then that way it's not, some people have been putting on the top or bottom, but we found just in the back was easier. And then also by ironing it, it gives you your four corners, which makes it a lot easier to ribbon and seam it. So this is one that we've already started, and we've just been using a fun ribbon that we found the grosgrain ribbon worked a little bit better. It's easier to tie. You know, a lot of people that are using masks are of age, and so we wanted something that they could use a plastic zip cord with and tie their masks easily, but also they stay tied really well. But we just feed the ribbon in through the filter and then pin it to a corner. And pinning's also important. But then just go ahead and seam it. I leave a little bit of a seam allowance, and again, backstitch. And do the other side. Some people, I think everyone has a different preference for how tight their seams are. I leave mine at 2.2. That's just a personal preference. And then just pull it out. I always trim the corners. I think when you go to turn it inside out and fold it, it just makes it a little bit of an easier crease. Take the pins out. I've made the mistake of forgetting to take the pins out. And then what was probably the most complicated thing for me to learn about with the mask, you turn it inside out, I just pull one of the ribbons through and it turns itself in. And you can see that this is one of our Longhorn designs. You can see you've got the filter pocket in the back, and it's nicely seamed. For me, the pleating was the hardest thing to learn. It really was sort of like an exercise in dexterity. I know that some directions say do three pleats. I only did two. I thought that when we were test driving the mask, they were a little bit more comfortable and had a little bit more give with just the two pleats. But again, it's preference. But we do about 1-inch pleats and just, you know, like so. And this is again where your iron comes in very handy. Definitely, I always just iron the back of the mask, flatten it down. It makes it easier to seam. And then this is an example. This is one that I already went ahead and pinned and ironed. And you can just see it's just gonna make it a little bit more easier to do a final stitch on. The other thing that just, you know, personal preference, but I have found that it's a little bit easier on the sewing machine if you use a 90 size needle. It's long enough that it can get through the thick material. I made the mistake of trying a smaller needle at one point, and I think my machine made a noise like it wanted to just explode. Sort of like that. But there you go. And then these are washable. We do suggest to people, just because we want them to last as long as possible, wash them in a garment bag. They just, so the ribbons don't, the ties don't get tied up. We've been asked a lot why we haven't used elastic. And again, we've just found when we test drove the elastic, it fell apart, even in the garment bag. And so we want, again, we're all gonna be wearing these masks for a while, so we want something that's gonna last you guys. There's a lot of different ways you can tie these. You can tie them in the back of your head. You can do a slip knot, so they're easy to get on and off. Like I said, we also have been giving people zip cords, those zip ties, so you can just, you know, on and off each time. You don't have to worry about it. I just wear mine around my ears because I'm putting it on and off so many times. Just do a cute bow and around my ears. Pleats, oops, hold on, wait a minute. There we go, pleats down, and you can just extend it to how big you want it to be. But the bow is just, it's just easy to put on and off. So that's just one of the ways we've been doing them. Hope that helps. If you have more questions or thoughts, just email us at info@sarahkleincreative. We're always happy to hear your feedback. Thanks so much.
Fair. This is Sarah Klein with Sarah Klein Santa Cruz. I am up early introducing myself as I am so honored to be a part of the fair this evening in their virtual shop. We didn't know about it until a little bit last minute, and I'm out of town, so I won't be able to be there this evening. But little quick hello, just to say thank you so much to all the people that follow me and support my art. It's kind of a surreal experience. You just kind of put yourself out there, and whatever feedback comes your way, it's quite rewarding and just humbling and so appreciative. Just all the people that give support and just say how much they appreciate and love my style and my perspective on art. So thank you. Little background, I think I just come from a really different background. I come from lots of artistic influence with family members and just experiences, not entirely professionally trained, but I have had my fair share of art school and art classes. I think when I go into looking into a project, or if I find something, there's kind of two different aspects that I do. One, I definitely, you know, someone says, oh, can you paint me a watercolor? And you have to really almost interview and give that person, you know, try to understand what they're kind of looking for, but then also be able to have your style because they want your style with their idea. Secondly, there's just like, I just get inspired by the little things in life, mostly nature, but also a lot of like graphic art. I think I really just love pop art. It's really fun. And pop culture is really fun, and color. I mean, color just sort of blows me away. It can just change the day and the mood since a heartbeat. So if there's something that just goes, ah, paint me. And then I think the final thing is it just brings up great sense of accomplishment. You know, you're kind of running around the rat race of life and all the things that we do. And definitely having a creative outlet is such a like special talent, I suppose, it's just an outlet of being able to sort of put whatever you're feeling on paper. So, one more thing, I think I would like to say, you know, I love the things that I've created. I love the designs that we have. I really look forward to the future, and just with all the support that people have put towards me, it really gives me the ability to go, okay, like I can really push myself and like go and make better and more creative designs as we go forward. So anyway, you guys enjoy and take a look at everything. Some things I think might be new, some things are old, but please enjoy yourselves. Thank you for coming out and in supporting all the artists with Renegade Craft Fair. This COVID-19 has been really hard, so, you know, it's put the pressure on everybody to, like, find a creative way to go forward and survive. So, anyway, have a lovely evening, and I'm going to turn the video over to my co-founder and my my rock and my cousin, my sister. She's huge support of everything, and her vision definitely helps in so many ways. So Jill Grant is gonna take it from here. So enjoy, guys, have a great night, bye.
Happy Friday, everyone. We're so glad you're here at the Renegade Art Craft Fair. I know it's a virtual pop-up and we wish we could all be in person, but hopefully this time next year we'll all be able to do that. But we're just really excited to be able to have this opportunity at Sarah Klein Santa Cruz. My name is Jill Grant. I'm the co-founder of Sarah Klein with my cousin Sarah. And we grew up together in California and just have always done business together and always, you know, just always been in each other's lives. And about a year and a half ago, Sarah has always done artwork, and she had this idea to put it on some organic pea gauze. It's a cotton, like a muslin. And she got sick of the kids dragging their wet beach towels through the house, and she lives right on the shore in Santa Cruz. And so she put on this pea gauze that, you know, dries quickly, it doesn't track sand, and so it made things a lot easier, sort of a mom convenience. And people started to see the wraps, and then we made these big beach sheets, like a picnic blanket, and started asking, you know, where do we buy these? And I live in Charlottesville, Virginia, and Sarah said, well, you've got the business background, can you figure out how we do production? And so I've just fortunately stumbled upon a great group of interns from the University of Virginia, and we've taken it from there that, you know, we started with really beach wraps and towels and sheets, but now we're moving more into like home goods. We've got these pillows with some of our new designs. I think one of the things that makes our enterprise interesting that I didn't realize walking into this is just that we didn't have the capital to hold a lot of inventory. We work out of my house, and so we've been able to work with companies like Printful, where we get our pillows and do drop shipments. So we sign off on a demo, and then when a customer makes an order, they just ship it directly to the customer, which has been great. And we're just excited to be part of this arts and crafts community. We've had so many people behind us that have been not just supportive, but really giving us great constructive feedback, showing us how business works. And we're proud to be part of tonight that's supporting the Black Arts Futures Fund. And we just look to this community as, you know, a good group that's collaborative and supportive of each other. Apparently my dog thinks that it's time to take a nap, but while he's taking a nap, I'm gonna show you guys a quick video of some of our products from last winter, and then we're gonna go make a margarita. So come join me. Thank you.
cocktails. I hope you enjoyed the little video that we showed you of our products. It was just from a pop-up we did last year. And we have a group of our interns who are here. Sarah and I could not get through the day without our interns from the University of Virginia. They're gonna talk a little bit about our products and what they do.
Hi, I'm Zoe.
And I'm Hannah.
And today we are wearing the new Sarah Klein Santa Cruz Captains. I'm wearing the Iris.
And I'm wearing the Blue Leaf.
And so these are so cool because they're made out of the same material as our wraps and our tea towels, which is the 100% organic pea gauze cotton. And it's super soft and super absorbent, which is why we love it. And we ended up turning it into these captains. So they're super new. We're just now adding them into the website. We're really excited about that. And then here we also have our tumblers. And these actually were my idea. So I'm super excited about them. And you can see the other ones in the back. And we've been using them for our cocktail hours, actually our virtual cocktail hours. And they've been a great addition and they include all of Sarah's designs. So this one is actually our Longhorn design, which has become one of our best sellers and is absolutely amazing. And throughout the year, we also do a ton of pop-ups, which Hannah can talk about.
We'll have all of these products and more at all our pop-ups. We do a lot across Virginia, our last one in Highland, I think it was. And come see us.
Yes, definitely. And back to Jill for some cocktails and some beeswax paper.
Thank you, guys. Okay, so as Zoe mentioned, we are big fans of this organic pea gauze. It was something that Sarah found. When, like I said earlier, when she got started, she found this pea gauze on Spoonflower and she was using it as beach towels and beach wraps. And then we figured, why not try it as a tea towel? Because it's so absorbent. And a lot of the dishcloths I get, they don't absorb a lot of water. And so we just added some of our designs to that. And it's nice because we can repurpose our pea gauze into the wraps, the captains, the tea towels. So we're gonna make a little cocktail really quickly. This is our pink grapefruit margarita, which only have one. I'm just gonna tell you that right now. Just drink one. They're a little strong, but 2 cups of pink grapefruit juice, 1 cup of white tequila. I just love Casamigos, but that's just my preference. And then 1 cup of Cointreau, and these are really strong. So as you can tell, but they're just a nice summer drink to nurse along. And then we just always love to just pour them into our tumblers. And serve them with some of our favorite guacamole, which is super easy. I'm just the queen of convenient cooking because I'm always on the go. So we do a guacamole with holy guacamole, and then I just add equal parts of tomato, cilantro, and red onion, and cocktail hour is ready. And as you saw, we used our beeswax paper to wrap up our guacamole, and Grace will talk a little bit about that because it's important to us that we use our scrap material and be a sustainable company and have another way of using our scraps.
Yeah, so I'm gonna talk a little bit about how we turn our scrap material into beeswax paper. So I take the beeswax, melt it down in the pot, and then once the beeswax is liquid, I just swipe it on to the pieces of scrap paper that we have, trying to do it as evenly as possible. Meanwhile, preheat the oven to 200 degrees, try to get it even, cover all the edges, and then as soon as they're done, you put it in the oven and the beeswax will soak through, and you can just use these little papers to cover up your food, like something that you would put in plastic wrap, so you don't have to waste stuff in your kitchen, and we can also be more sustainable in how we use our paper.
Yeah, and I think Grace made a great find. A lot of times when you read the directions to make beeswax paper, they say wax on both sides, like put it in the oven for a few minutes at 200 degrees, pull it out, and then turn it over and add beeswax to the other side. And we just found that it was getting too thick.
So it was getting too thick.
Yeah, so we just are doing it one side, and I think with the cotton that we're using, it's the same cotton we're using for our face mask. It just sort of penetrates and just, yeah, it just goes right through.
It just soaks through, and then it has an even coating on both sides.
Yeah, so Awesome. So we're going to take you now, as you can tell, we work out of my house, and I think that we are probably like most small businesses are just getting started. So we're gonna take you into what was my dining room and is now one of our work rooms where we've got some of our new table linens set up, and then Amanda Geyer, another UVA intern, is going to show how she's taken some of our other scrap material and turned it into scrunchies that we've just been giving away with orders, because it's just sort of nice to put a little something in with each order that we get, and so come with me.
All right, come follow me. We're gonna go look at some of our new table linens and learn how to make a scrunchie with our intern, Amanda. So we have been really lucky that we have a Spoon Flower who has a company called Roostery that we can mock up any sort of table designs. Like, we've got table placemats, table runners, napkins, and we don't have to order inventory. We're able to mock it up, take samples to pop-ups with us, or have it on our website, and then when people order it, we just ship it directly to them. It's been wonderful, but also it just saves us a lot of money. I mean, we're a new company and we have to, you know, watch every penny, and so to be able to have a company like Spoon Flower and Roostery where we can mock things up, try things out, you know, for instance, we've tried the placemats in a couple of different types of material. This is the material, a more rough cotton that we like, just because most people are gonna use it for outdoor use. But we're gonna start bringing these to pop-ups and have them on our website in the next few weeks. And Amanda Geyer, who's a fourth year at UVA, is going to show you guys how to make a scrunchie. So, and because of the sustainability piece, we think it's really important to not waste any material. So we've taken old pea gauze from wraps that we cut and we've turned them into scrunchies. And Amanda's gonna show you guys how to do it because it's super easy.
Hi guys. So first thing you wanna do when you're gonna make the scrunchie is you wanna cut your fabric. And this piece of fabric is 3.5 inches wide by 22 inches long. But if you wanted to have a thicker, fluffier scrunchie, you can adjust that to 4.5 inches wide by 20 inches long. And the first step is to fold your fabric lengthwise with the print on the inside. So it's gonna be inside out. And then you're gonna sew a seam right on the edge here. Elastic inside. So for a scrunchie this size, we're going to use a 9-inch piece of elastic, but like I said before, if you wanted one that's thicker, you could trim that down to 6 inches. And this part's a little bit tricky, so it helps if you pin the elastic to one end of the fabric, and then you just got to kind of reach through and pull your elastic, and it takes a minute.
But then it's good for people to see how this isn't always easy. We were always sort of like, you know, improvising. But the scrunchies are, that's been the biggest piece with the scrunchies, is just the elastic piece. So, but once you get it through, which I think it looks like you've got.
Yeah, so once you've got it pulled through, it starts to take the shape of an actual scrunchie. And you can pull your pin out and grab your other end. And then you just want to tie it in a simple knot, like this. And then you just kind of position the ends so that they overlap. And then the last step is just to sew one more seam right here to connect it all. And then you just trim your thread. That can be a little tricky with some sewing machines because it likes to grab the fabric. I
can't get it out. So it'll end up looking something like this as your finished product.
Awesome, Amanda, thank you. Amanda's been a superstar. This is what she's been focusing on the last few weeks. Okay, so next up is Hildy. She's been just graduated from UVA. She's going to take you into our workroom and show you a little bit about our scarves and wraps and whatnot. So let's go.
So this is our workshop. It's the back room of Jill's house, and as you can see, we've had to kind of make the most of the little space that we have here, like any small business that runs out of the home. So one of the things that I know Jill has talked about a lot and is really important to our company is the fact that we use the same material for a lot of our different products, and we try to innovate and create new stuff with that. So, for example, we have our beach sheet, which is made out of the same organic 100% cotton material that the caftans and the tea towels are all made out of. So this is our orange starfish pattern in the beach sheet. And that can be used as like a picnic blanket, a beach blanket, towel, really anything. It's a great, just big material thing for you to use. And then the second other popular product that we use is our beach wrap, and this is our pineapple print. And the beach wraps are great because you can use them as a sarong. I can show you, you can tie them sort of like this, and you get a little cute little skirt going on there. Or you can use them as more of like a wrap shawl-esque kind of thing when you're out of the water, kind of dry off. These are really, really absorbent, so they're great to use at the pool, at the beach, really anything, or just for a fashion statement, if you wanted to do that too. And then also in here we have our scarves that are made out of a chiffon material, and they're super lightweight, really kind of almost transparent, but not really. And they come in a bunch of different patterns. They go with all kinds of stuff, like a white t-shirt and jeans would be a great look for our scarves. And then we also have all of our note cards that are made out of some pretty heavy duty cardstock. So they don't bend, they hold up really well in the mail. We've got all of our different animal patterns and prints that you can send for thank you notes, all that kind of stuff. So yeah, this is where the magic happens. And now we're gonna show you how to make one of these beautiful wraps.
So I hope you guys enjoyed learning how to make a wrap. This was all new to me. A year and a half ago, I had never even touched a sewing machine. I didn't know what a serger was. And I was really lucky that there's an awesome yarn store and sewing store in Charlottesville, U-Fibers, that literally has shown me how to do everything from serging to sewing to making dresses. So you're never too old to take on a new hobby or learn a new skill set I've learned. But probably the thing that I'm most excited about as we're getting to the holiday season, and I know it seems it's a far away, far, far away, but when I used to consult with QVC, they started their Christmas selling at the end of July. So I'm gonna just follow their lead since they seem to know what they're doing. But this is our new Minky throw blanket, which I don't know about you guys, but when I love the wintertime, I like hole up, I'm always reading books on my couch, and I just love something comfy and cozy. This is also something that you can just put at the end of your bed during the summertime. This is our banana leaf print, which is new. And Taylor, our intern, is waving her favorite Minky blanket, her Dia de los Muertos. Taylor.
It's just really nice and lightweight. It's a fun pattern. And like Jill said, I also love being super cozy. Who doesn't? And it's a fun thing to just throw around you when you're going around the house or kind of chilling on the couch. Add a little pop of color, make something fun and different. And what's super cool about the Minky material is it's nice and warm, but not too heavy, so you're not feeling overwhelmed by this big blanket on maybe a cooler summer afternoon or evening.
No, and I think you're right that that's what I was learning, because like I hate having in the summer like the duvet cover.
Yeah, exactly.
It's too much, but this is like a perfect weight for like a light blanket. And this also is just sort of giving us some inspiration for bedding, which we're looking at right now. We have this awesome company in Portugal that we're hoping to work with. And we're hoping by the holidays to have some bedding out. So if you have thoughts of patterns you'd like to see, we're thinking mussels, banana leaves, what else?
Feathers, I believe.
The feathers as well. And the blue leaves, the caftan, that same pattern that Hannah was wearing. So anyways, thank you guys for tuning in and just getting to learn a little about our business. We are so grateful for the support we've had, and this truly was an organic endeavor. It was, as I said earlier, Sarah had some artwork and she put it on this pea gauze, and I have a business background. And you know, we've been so blessed with the community of artists and craftsmen that have taken us under their wing and shown us how to do business and how to make things work. And we hope that as we evolve, we can support the artists that are emerging. And just that, you know, this is a good community and there's room for all of us, and just let's all be collaborative. And we're just glad to have this evening tonight. So thank you. I'm back. Okay, so we've had a bunch of questions come in about some of our products and dimensions, and just a little more information people were wondering about the